On July 3, 1941, fire trucks raced through the city, delivering copies of a special edition of the Huntsville Times, announcing that a totally new era was about to begin in North Alabama. Tiny farming communities in the Huntsville area received news that they would soon be affected by profound changes. Names like Pond Beach, Mullins Flat, and Hickory Grove, used locally for generations, would soon disappear. The army was coming. Huntsville would never be the same. The only remaining pre-army structure on post is the Harris House, a home that existed in the area of Madison County, Alabama, that became Redstone Arsenal. This film is going to take you on a journey that highlights the remarkable history of achievement here at Redstone. The Arsenal does indeed have a very proud past and an even brighter future. On August 4th, 1941, Brigadier General Rollo Ditto, who was a colonel at the time, broke ground for Huntsville Arsenal, whose personnel manufactured chemicals and loaded them into bombs, grenades, and shells. Realizing that it would be extremely economical to locate an ordnance shell loading assembly plant close to the Huntsville Arsenal, the Army's Chief of Ordnance decided to build a facility named Redstone Ordnance Plant, adjacent to Huntsville Arsenal. Ground was broken for the plant on October 25, 1941. The plant was redesignated Redstone Arsenal on February 26, 1943. It manufactured ammunition items and assembled the items loaded at Huntsville Arsenal into complete rounds. Wartime employment totaled nearly 20,000 for both arsenals. The Army and its civilian workforce labored around the clock to meet production schedules. A large portion of the workforce were women and other minorities who worked in the difficult and oftentimes dangerous jobs of loading and manufacturing operations. They did that job extremely well. Today's tradition of excellence had its roots here, for by the war's end, these two arsenals had met or surpassed every goal. They often pioneered production techniques that were adopted elsewhere throughout the Army. Once World War II ended, the enormous payroll disappeared. The focus at both arsenals shifted from production to the demilitarization and salvaging of munitions and the deactivation of these huge manufacturing facilities. The modern-day practice of leasing some of the lands on the arsenal had its origin here. Also, some of the empty buildings were leased to private enterprise, most notably the Keller Motors Corporation. This company actually tried to make the Huntsville area the Detroit of the South. As the 1940s were nearing an end, things looked bleak for both installations. Redstone Arsenal was on standby status, and Huntsville Arsenal was advertised for sale. But events would soon happen that would totally transform these facilities and open an entirely new chapter to the installation's history. When Major General Hoger, or as he preferred to be called, Ludi Toftoy, left Redstone in 1958, the citizens of Huntsville and Madison County erected this plaque in his honor here in Big Spring Park. They called him Mr. Missile. When it came to Redstone Arsenal, he was a true visionary. It was Toftoy who recognized the value of bringing Wernher von Braun and his team of German scientists and engineers to the United States as World War II ended. After much persuasion, he was able to bring key members of this team and their equipment to the United States, where they settled at Fort Bliss, Texas. By 1948, Toftoy realized that the management of the Ordnance Corps' rocket activities needed to be decentralized into a field organization. He picked Redstone Arsenal as the home of the Corps' consolidated rocket activities. Redstone came back to life when the Chief of Ordnance officially reactivated it on June 1, 1949. Colonel Hudson returned to lead the arsenal into this new era. After learning that Fort Bliss could not accommodate the new facilities needed for the Army's growing guided missile mission, Ludi Toftoy became the catalyst for relocating the von Braun team to the facilities located at Huntsville Arsenal. Toftoy often told the story of being sent by the Chief of Ordnance to meet with General Matthew Ridgway, the Army Vice Chief of Staff, to try and convince him to permit the move of the Fort Bliss mission to the old Huntsville Arsenal area. Toftoy recalled that his map was so large that he had to spread it across the floor. He soon found that his pointer was not long enough, so he had to crawl around on the map as he pled his case. Finally, Toftoy found himself on his hands and knees right next to General Ridgway. He looked up at the general, gave him a big smile, and said, "I'm really on my hands and knees, literally and figuratively, begging for this place." Thanks to Toftoy's tenacity and the shrewd lobbying by Senator John Sparkman, Congressman Bob Jones, and officials from the Huntsville area, the Secretary of the Army approved the transfer of the Von Braun team on October 28, 1949. By the time they arrived in April 1950, Huntsville Arsenal's land and facilities had been consolidated into Redstone Arsenal. The Army at Redstone thus entered a decade that brought it worldwide acclaim. When Colonel Hudson returned to Redstone in November 1948, the arsenal only had about 250 employees. That number climbed dramatically throughout the decade, totaling more than 16,900 by June 30, 1960. As Redstone grew, so did the city of Huntsville, which had a population of about 16,000 in 1950. By 1960, its population had increased about 350%, totaling more than 72,000. Colonel Hudson increased Redstone's mission even further on March 3, 1952, when he established the Provisional Redstone Ordnance School, the forerunner of today's Ordnance Missile and Munitions Center and School. By 1956, scientists, engineers, and technicians at Redstone had transformed such weapon systems as the Honest John, Little John, Corporal, Sergeant, Redstone, Hawk, Nike Ajax, and Nike Hercules from dreams and plans into realities. Redstone's success with these projects prompted the Army to expand the arsenal's mission even more by creating the Army Ballistic Missile Agency, or ABMA, on February 1, 1956, under the leadership of Major General John Bruce Medeiros. The Von Braun team was assigned to this new agency. Always sharply dressed, sporting his trademark mustache, and with his characteristic swagger stick, Medeiros commanded ABMA and later the Army Ordnance Missile Command, or AOMC, from 1956 to 1960, one of the most nationally publicized periods of the arsenal's history. A flamboyant leader, Medeiros was granted special powers covering nearly every authority in the development and procurement field. Frequently, he could be seen on national television or testifying before Congress, urging funding for his programs. He did well at this too, with his budget for fiscal years 1959 and 1960 approaching $2 billion, or about 25% of the Army's budget for those years. When Medeiros' team began their work in 1956, they had the primary mission of fielding the Army's first intermediate-range ballistic missile, which came to be known as the Jupiter. By August 1958, this system was delivered to the Air Force for early deployment overseas. The Jupiters later proved to be a significant bargaining chip in the Cuban Missile Crisis. During his command, Medeiros' team also had several other notable achievements in the missile and rocket field, as they fielded the Redstone and Nike Hercules, accelerated the development of the Nike Zeus, which would, a few years later, become a core element of the Nike X Project Office, a predecessor of today's Army Space and Missile Defense Command, and initiated the development of the Red Eye anti-aircraft system. They also began the development of the Pershing missile system, a system whose improvements would later play a major role in ending the Cold War. However, Medeiros' real legacy was as the godfather of the American space program. This is the Goddard House, which served as a VIP quarters during General Medeiros' tenure. Right behind it once stood an officer's club where Mr. Neil McElroy, Secretary of Defense-elect, dined on October 4, 1957, after an orientation tour of the arsenal. While at dinner, the news came that the Soviets had launched Sputnik 1, the first man-made object into orbit above the Earth. Legend has it that Dr. Von Braun asked to be given the green light and the Army could launch a satellite in 60 days. General Medeiros asked for a little longer, 90 days. About a month later, the Soviet Union announced the launching of a second satellite, Sputnik 2. These Soviet satellites shattered American dreams of scientific and technical superiority. Amid mounting public pressure to respond to this Soviet challenge and repeated problems with the Navy-managed satellite program known as Project Vanguard, the Army was given the go-ahead on November 8, 1957, to prepare a Jupiter C that would launch the first U.S. satellite.
Let's go, Werner.
Just 84 days after receiving the mission, the Army team at Redstone launched Explorer 1 on January 31, 1958. This team had faced and met the challenge that not only restored U.S. prestige, but also served as the impetus for the extraordinary growth and tradition of excellence that has become a hallmark of both the Redstone and Huntsville communities. As news stories of the Explorer 1's launch began to surface, thousands of people gathered on the courthouse square in Huntsville. Sirens wailed, horns blasted, and the sky filled with store-bought rockets and fireworks celebrating this country's first step toward the conquest of space. These celebrations were echoed across the nation. However, even before being assigned the Explorer 1 mission, the Army team at Redstone had already recovered intact the nose cone of a Jupiter C it had flight tested on August 8, 1957. This marked the first time that a man-made object had been retrieved from outer space. This recovery also proved the suitability of the nose cone's ablative type heat protection. But the winds of change were swirling. On July 29, 1958, President Eisenhower signed into law the National Aeronautics and Space Act, which established the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, or NASA. NASA, which was activated on October 1, 1958, by its administrator, Dr. T. Keith Glennon, was given the responsibility of conducting scientific exploration of outer space for peaceful purposes. About a year later, in October 1959, General Medeiros announced that he would be retiring, effective January 31, 1960. One day after Medeiros' announcement, President Eisenhower announced that he had concluded that the Von Braun team could, quote, best serve the national interest as an integral part of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. Before the Von Braun team's transfer to NASA, the Army at Redstone had several other noteworthy achievements in laying the foundation for U.S. space exploration. Some of these included launching the first successful American lunar probe and the first U.S. satellite to go into permanent orbit around the sun, initiating the development of the million-pound thrust engine that became the nation's moon rocket, and recovering the first living beings, monkeys Abel and Baker, from a flight into outer space. This recovery paved the way for putting the first man into orbit. On July 1, 1960, Major General August Schoenberg commented that he felt like the father of the bride as he officially transferred about 4,700 Army Civil Service employees and more than $100 million in facilities and equipment at Redstone and Cape Canaveral, Florida, to Dr. Von Braun, the new director of NASA's George C. Marshall Space Flight Center. Yet, it is important to remember that within a year after the transfer, May 5, 1961, it was an Army-modified Redstone that provided the initial boost for America's first manned space flight of Commander Alan B. Shepard. An Army-modified Redstone also served as the booster for the Mercury flight of Virgil Grissom in July of that same year. Thus, the first American manned space flights were based solidly on Army contributions. Many soldiers and civilians who today come to work for the Army at Redstone Arsenal are amazed when they learn of the significant role that the Army played in paving the way for the U.S. space program. From these roots grew a spirit of achievement, a legacy that has continued even after the Army at Redstone lost its space mission. Never at a loss for words, Medeiros was asked to speak to the Huntsville Chamber of Commerce on January 31, 1978, to help commemorate the 20th anniversary of the Explorer 1 launch. By then a priest, Medeiros noted, "I do choose to remind the historians of Huntsville that the Army led the city from cotton and watercress to become the space capital of the United States." At the beginning of the 1960s, the Army at Redstone focused on using what it had learned to get into space and applying that knowledge to supply our soldiers in the field with the best possible weapons. So began the third phase of Redstone Arsenal's remarkable history. By 1962, the Army was undergoing a sweeping reorganization. One of the results of this reorganization was the creation of the U.S. Army Materiel Command, or AMC. One of AMC's major subordinate commands was the U.S. Army Missile Command. MICOM, as it was commonly called, was activated on August 1, 1962, under the command of Major General Francis McMorrow. Building 5250 stood as the command headquarters building for the next 32 years. One of the significant changes was the establishment of project managers for missile system programs. Systems initially singled out for project management included the Nike Hercules, Pershing, Sergeant, Lance, and Hawk. During the 1960s and 70s, much of the technology the arsenal had been working on began to mature. Redstone added a number of project offices during this time. Some of these included TOW, Dragon, Stinger, Hellfire, Chaparral FAR, the General Support Rocket System, or MLRS as it came to be called, and the Patriot. It was also during this period, in May 1974, that all ballistic missile defense efforts were consolidated under a single manager in the Ballistic Missile Defense Organization, which eventually evolved into today's U.S. Army Space and Missile Defense Command. Redstone got a pretty good idea of how well it was doing in June 1967 during the Six-Day War. Israeli troops downed several Egyptian jets with Hawk missiles, marking the first combat firings of U.S. Army missiles. The TOW missile, mounted on a UH-1B Huey, became the first American-made guided missile to be fired by U.S. troops in combat. These first combat firings of the airborne TOW occurred on May 2, 1972. Serving in Vietnam until January 1973, the airborne TOW compiled an impressive record. The arsenal dedicated the Francis J. McMorrow Missile Laboratories on March 12, 1964, in memory of General McMorrow, who died while still in command. The research, development, and engineering facilities here have the reputation for being among the best in the Army. They have consistently forged advancements in technology to meet both current and future Army materiel requirements. McMorrow Labs has been an important center for laser research. Redstone scientists and engineers even helped the National Cancer Institute investigate the use of lasers to destroy malignant tumors. They also pioneered the laser guidance concepts and techniques used by the Air Force in the development of their laser-guided smart bombs, which were used so effectively during Desert Storm. In the 1980s, the Army began building in great quantities many of the weapons that Redstone Arsenal had developed in the 1960s and 70s. One of the best examples would be the Pershing II. First deployed in 1983, this system's increased range and pinpoint accuracy were major factors in influencing the Soviet Union to sign the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty in 1987. The Pershing had done its job and was retired with honor. It was appropriate that on a hot Alabama day, July 16, 1988, the seemingly unthinkable happened. A team of Soviet inspectors came to Redstone Arsenal to inspect Pershing facilities. The Cold War was melting away. 1991, Desert Shield, Desert Storm operations unfolded. This was the largest deployment and subsequent combat use of missiles in Army history. Virtually every one of Redstone's missile systems was deployed. In fact, Hellfire missiles launched from Apache helicopters fired the first shots of the war, taking out early warning radars and paving the way for the Air Force air war. The Hellfire and TOW missiles went on to destroy hundreds of Iraqi tanks, personnel carriers, and other vehicles during the course of the war. MLRS rockets rained down on the Iraqi artillery units and other targets so effectively that the Iraqis referred to it as steel rain. And who can ever forget the Patriot, or the Scud Buster as it came to be called? Once again, the Army at Redstone had risen to the challenge. After the war ended, Huntsville had a Celebration of Patriots parade.
Join us for the Celebration of Patriots parade on June 11th.
As part of the community's Armed Forces Week activities to welcome home all of its Gulf War heroes. The Army team at Redstone had clearly proven that when we were needed, we were there. The 1990s saw Redstone Arsenal embarking on the fourth chapter of its proud history. The installation had fully adapted to a whole new means of executing the project management programs. After the Gulf War ended, Redstone began positioning itself to answer the call as the Army prepared to restructure its force and consolidate its activities. One of Redstone's strengths has been the excellent relations it has had with the Huntsville community over the years. One example of that cooperative spirit is the amount of land that the Army here has donated to the local community and the state to improve the quality of life in this area. Examples of the more than 880 acres of donated land include such sites as the U.S. Space and Rocket Center and the adjacent hotel, Morris Elementary School, the Huntsville Botanical Garden, recreational facilities, and a Naval Reserve Center. Redstone's potential for growth was further enhanced by the fact that it had won a number of Army Communities of Excellence Awards in the early 1990s. This was a direct result of Redstone's total commitment to providing outstanding, world-class customer service. For a time in the early 1990s, Redstone officials and community leaders could be seen making numerous trips back and forth to Rock Island, Illinois, urging the workers there to consider moving to Huntsville should a proposed merger of their facilities with those of Redstone take place. While that move never materialized, Redstone continued positioning itself for the 21st century when it dedicated the John J. Sparkman Center in August 1994. When it opened, this $67 million state-of-the-art facility consisted of over 680,000 square feet. It soon became a model for future government construction requirements. Expansion over the next few years increased its capacity to over 990,000 square feet. July 17, 1997, was a landmark in Redstone Arsenal's history. On that day, the former Army Missile Command combined with the aviation portion of the U.S. Army Aviation and Troop Command. A new organization, the U.S. Army Aviation and Missile Command, or AMCOM, was born. The Army had now entrusted Redstone Arsenal with the management of two key components of the Army after next, missile firepower and aviation platforms. The greatest resource of Redstone has always been its people, starting with those who labored on the production lines here back during World War II. The people of Redstone have made excellence the cornerstone of their work. That tradition of success will continue to make Redstone an enduring installation as we move forward in the 21st century.